Welcome to the Pembroke Conservation Commission meeting for Monday, October 17th. We have several things tonight. First, do you have that sheet to read about the video?
It's right there.
It's an open meeting, and the names of the members present are Rick Madden, Art Edgerton, Greg Welch, Sharon Tools, Scott Globin, and Bobby Clark. Please note that this meeting is being made available to the public through video and audio broadcasts on Pembroke Town News for the broadcast of future dates. Anything said in this meeting will be recorded. Okay. So we have a hearing at 7:40, but there's a few discussions, so let's go to the first discussion. A request for abatement, MGL C-59. The Board of Assessors at 190 Barker Street. Do we have some paperwork on that? Mary, can you help me at all? I don't know what this is. Request for abatement.
When we acquire a piece of property, we have to request an abatement of the taxes to the Board of Assessors.
Okay.
So we were notified by the Board of Assessors that we acquired a property at 190 Barker Street. And in the packet which is signed, there is the request.
All right.
So in the mail folder is the notice.
Well, basically, what they're saying is if we don't fill out the paperwork, they want us to pay the town taxes on our own property.
That makes a lot of sense.
On our own property.
On our property.
Well, they'd probably double dip if they could.
Okay, here it is. Request for abatement. Please accept this memo as a request for an abatement of portion FY17 taxes for the property located at 190 Barker Street, as shown on the assessor's map, D10, lot 14, consisting of approximately 29.087 acres. The property was accepted by the Conservation Commission on July 25th, 2016, and the deed was recorded by the Plymouth County Registry of Deeds on July 29th, 2016. If you have any questions, please let me know. And that's from the Board of Assessors. All right. Anyone can sign that.
What is there on that? Is it all filled out, Mary? We just have to sign it? Is that...
I
move where we request an abatement for 190 Barker Street.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
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 Ayes have it. I think I'll sign all that stuff anyways. Copperwood Estates Hall Road, did you have something on that, Bobby?
Yes and no. I mean, it was progressing to a point, but it's my interpretation. Now, it's only mine. I don't want anyone to think it's official. That they haven't signed the papers with the MAC, with the bog people, to get the material out of there yet. And till that's signed, they can't, they don't, nobody wants to keep going ahead of the game.
Didn't they want to have started work already, didn't they?
they've done all the cutting, yeah. And they're doing some stumping. I mean, they're ready for it. Originally, they wanted to be hauling by this time, but there's something in their part of it that's holding it up. I know the Copperwood people wanted to come into the ballpark area and do some of the clearing. Maybe I have to step back, and I don't know how far. Sometimes I'm not sure what you people know already.
Yeah, that's what we talked about that
what
last
we've time. Talked about in town hall, selectmen and all, and recreation, is that there is a base plan for developing that whole park area down there, soccer fields, lacrosse fields, and all that. And it's been kind of on hold because of lack of funds. They figured they were putting all their efforts into the Matakesit fields before they started somewhere else. Well, now that this Hall Road, Copperwood, and all has come about, kind of as a, because we'll let you drive across our land, but when we get done, we want the ball fields to be roughed all in, and, you know, it's a, what can we get out of you for doing it?
Right, and, we don't want just the trees cut down.
And they've been pretty much saying, yeah, we'll do almost all of the work. At least that's the way I interpret it, but nothing is written down. And they were ready to come in and start cutting last week at the end, as soon as they finished across the street. And I talked with Ed, and we both agreed, well, no, I don't want them doing anything till we have more on paper as to what we're going to get at the very end. So it's kind of in a stagnant area right now, but it could bust loose any time and go, because they want to get some material in there.
So do they have to come before us again, or we already sent that?
No, you people
gave me permission
to do what was best for the board, because it's one of the things that might be a tomorrow morning that all of a sudden everybody decides they need to get together and make a decision, because we're working against the weather. That's a problem this time of year. It's a matter of a few days can make all the difference in the world what they're doing.
We've seen snow 36 inches deep on Thanksgiving.
Yeah, don't talk about that, Rick. We don't even want to think about that.
That word's taboo right now.
So as a Hall Road is kind of in limbo at the moment, but could break loose anytime.
Okay. Is it 7:40, right? Who knows what ANRAD is?
7:40.
Mary, can you tell me what ANRAD is?
This is the resource area delineation for 17 Mining Deck. We hired, or we requested money to hire an outside consultant. Lenore White submitted a bid from Wetland Strategies, and we're still waiting for the money from Harbor One Bank owns the property right now.
Okay.
So when that money comes, they can do it. So they have requested a hearing.
Oh, let's continue it. Okay. Okay, so we vote on to continue it?
Make a motion.
Can we have a second for that motion to vote
second.
On?
Second.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? The ayes have it. And the same thing for...
We have to wait 10 minutes.
Oh, okay. Oh, I see. All right.
Another 5 minutes.
Okay, so that was enough with the Copper Estates. Did you have anything else, Bobby?
I'd like to request an extension. Do we want to do these one at a time or do them as a group? They're all requests for extensions. Now let's go one at a time because they're not all the same. I move for... request an extension for an ORAD for the Center Street DEP file number 56876. These are all highway paperwork that we have ongoing.
Okay. Can you tell me what an ORAD is?
An ORAD is an order of resource area delineation that once we approve these ANRADs from Raleigh Mac and High Street, the document that we will issue is an ORAD.
Okay.
Stands for order of resource area delineation.
We're accepting the wetland line that was that's
marks.
On the drawings that was given to us originally that we checked on.
Yeah, they did a little bit of change for us and themselves and really speedily did it. Very good.
Okay, so should we vote on?
Yep.
Okay. Can I have a motion to approve the ORAD for Center Street? DEP file. SC56.
Well, we need to extend it for 3 years.
Yeah.
I should have put that
for
in
three
the
years.
Motion. 3 year extension.
Years.
So we have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
I'm going to abstain.
Okay. One abstention. And nays? Ayes have it.
And I'd like to request an extension on ORAD for Harbor Mark Street file number 56877, for 3 years. Basically, it's the same thing, only another one of the other high roads.
Yeah, 3 years. Okay, can I have a motion for that? For a red at Hobnox Street?
Yeah. I have a motion?
Yep. And a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Can I abstain?
That's abstaining. Robbie?
And I'd like to request an extension for an order of conditions for the Hobnox Street. That's file number 56894.
So that's a request to extend a current order of conditions?
Order of conditions, okay. Right.
Make a motion to extend that order of conditions for 3 years.
Do we have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Abstain.
Doug Steens? Any notes? Guys have it. Herbicides. Herbicides, the reason why that's on there, I've been waiting for Scott to get back to ask about this. We approved a payment for some herbicides.
Yep.
Can you tell me what that was for?
That is for when the wild parsnip is removed and put at the Monroe Street pit. We're going to try treating with it.
Okay. And you haven't used it yet?
Nope. Both containers are in my truck. Actually, one's in my truck, one's in the garage. They both haven't been opened yet.
Okay. Thank you.
And if you like, here are the safety sheets list everything.
Is there anything that you could use to kill them besides those? They're pretty harsh chemicals to be using anywhere.
That's
actually
what we've been standing around town for years on.
It doesn't make them good.
No, I'm not saying it is, but that's what we've used around town for years.
I'm pretty green, and in this particular case, we're not trying to get rid of crabgrass or anything. We're trying to get rid of a really pestilent, horrible thing. They do have other ways of tarping and steaming and stuff. I heard the state does, but it's a long process. And I think tarping would be the smartest thing. Tarp it.
As far as I know,
for treatment, tarp it. If you want to treat it, tarp it. That's what I'm trying to say.
Don't let me step out of turn with Bobby, but I've been around for 2 months.
Yep.
But as far as I know, I don't think it's going to happen this year because they're getting ready to shut down for the winter.
Right.
In the spring, they're going to dig it all up. We're going to put it at the Monroe Street pit, cover it, and try to kill it that way.
Covering it would be the first thing, and then go from there, because then we still have to deal with the next issue separate in the wetlands thing and go forward on that one. But I think it's good to know. We wake up in the spring, it wakes up, and we take care of it. And I still, on the parsnip, we can't do enough deadheading when it's 2 or 3 feet tall, I don't believe, and still want to approach that in the spring if we're still plagued by it. Every darn top you get off is 500 less plants down the road.
Well, this is the first year I've got poison ivy in 51 years, so to be honest, I'm staying away from all that stuff.
Julie, take care of it, boom, and prevent her from, no, just know it, because it's got anything you get all over the colony, better than anything.
Yeah. I just want the board to know, both of these are over-the-counter.
Yeah, they were both.
They do not require a pesticide license or anything. Any one of us can purchase these. And
has it always been like that?
Razor burn, you used to have to have a license for.
Well, certain chemicals and quantities and all that, it goes by quantity a lot of time also.
But those are no license required to buy them.
These are anybody can get it, as long as you apply them according to the sheets and it's perfectly.
That what I bought there is what I don't know what they call themselves now, but it used to be Lesco. I think it's John Deere Site or something right now. Explained to him, showed him the pictures of what you gave us, and that's what he come up in as a computer.
I've used herbicides throughout my life at specific times, and I think if we could, I personally would go in there and hockey puck, hockey stick every one of those damn things in this fight.
We're in a very peculiar type of thing, because not only are we working in the area of a wetland, but we're also working within the area of a public highway. And so we've got rules upon rules upon rules of what we can do that's legal.
And if we had to go about this ourselves without landers, and we had to apply for the insurance policies to cover that, it would be astronomical. It would be a lot of money. Every layer that you just said is more money.
Yeah.
So this is a great thing they're going to do. It really is.
Yeah.
I really want to thank you, Bob, for handling it and getting it done.
Well, it's, well, again, if we run into trouble, and this is, I'm just looking farther down, on our part, we can do this. We can dig out again, but we're hoping for a better solution over there because we don't want to.
I don't know other solutions other than odds. They'll root it right out.
As you probably have heard, that the selectmen, the select people, or someone at the corner office had looked into hiring goats. And the goats were pretty much ready to come, except the goats were already booked up for the until winter time. But
we may have our own goats very soon.
But again, after I started looking into it, the goats are only going to eat to ground level. So that's fine for maybe your poison ivy you want to get rid of on the top or something else, but it wouldn't really solve the problem we have.
You'd have to do it repeatedly for like 3 years or something. Deadheading would be just as effective.
So we're still open on all of that to do, but we're working on it as best we can.
Okay.
Just a thought, if we are going to be treating it in different ways and have a hard winter, it might behoove us to mow the area when everything's locked up on ice, not moving around, in preparation for whatever we're going to do. That's just a thought, throw it up there.
I'm also wondering if we need to secure the area more. Rick, do you think we need to secure the area more or not?
I think everybody in town knows about it. I don't know about other towners, but I think signs wouldn't hurt just for general information to educate people at this point about it, but also for the future. But also, like I just said, at what point are they an asset or a distraction on that road? It's so fast and hard there.
Well, that's what I say. It's a two-point. I mean, the more we isolate the area, the more it becomes obvious to people that are there. If you don't make a big thing of it, most of the people don't know it's there and don't care.
I'd be willing to walk it and actually put a tape around the whole outer wetland area of it from that backside. I think that would show area. And then I would think the sign, since they're selling Christmas trees there and stuff, that would be an opportunity in time to show people the pictures then and educate people when they're slowed down. It's kind of senseless because it's harmless in the winter. That's the good thing about it. But maybe they don't want to pick some nice thing and bring it home to put it in the Christmas space. I don't know.
I think we need to at least tell the Christmas tree people
be surprised
that, sell your Christmas trees this way, not that way.
Yeah.
Don't go back in the woods.
Again, communication is an important thing. I think education, if you can work it in anywhere on the subject, is worthy of putting it in there, though. I would say in the spring. It's not relative. We should put up signs in the spring when the snow plows won't take them down and then use it that way. And maybe you could go online and tell people what they say so they don't have to stop and read them. If you want to know what the signs are, go to.
Yeah.
Put that big sign up there saying, go to this site.
Then they'll do it while they're driving.
That's true.
I think come spring there's going to be enough confusion in that area.
It's 7:53, so so this is another continuation of NRAD for off High Street and 4th Street for Frank found the SC56-971. So that's a continuation for a year also.
We're continuing it
for
till November 7th.
What's this one here? Okay, till November 7th. Was that the first one was November 7th also?
Yeah, the first one was October 20th.
day. Probably have the date on that.
This particular one, we do have our money for.
Nope.
Okay. Yeah, can I have a motion for that?
Make a motion.
And a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
It's unanimous. All right. Next thing we have is at 8 o'clock, so move on. Yeah, I'll do that after.
You do.
We have a request by Boy Scout Pack 105 to use Herringbone Park on Sunday, October 23rd. It's 2 p.m. to 4 p.m. for an outdoor pack meeting and the use of a grill fire. Anyone have any issues with that? Anything to say?
I think they just need to make sure they contact the fire department before they use the grill on that. And I don't know if the grates are in the building for the grill or not.
I haven't looked to see them, but...
I think they're on the grill.
I think they're on the grill.
Oh, okay. I know they used to put, every once in a while, they put them away so nobody took them.
If anybody ever does need them, I have to take like 3x4 foot racks that I use myself.
And I have a key to the hut there if you need, if it turns out you don't have them.
Roughly in that area, we have some maintenance problems at the Herring Run. They need to be attended to fairly quick. One of the windows in the shack is missing.
Really?
Didn't know that.
Sharon called that to our attention. We have a bridge that has at least one board that needs to be replaced while we're deciding what we're going to do with the whole thing. I mean, it's only a piece of 2x6, but we have a few things we need to have done down there. We have a big list of other things that we need to do down there, or would like to do, some of which will probably go in with a big program, some of which we need to take care of ourselves. I think Sharon has called my attention, and probably some of the others. Flagpole really needs some attention down there. It's kind of limping to one side, and that's not exactly what we need to do.
It was pretty wet when it got set, so.
I would be in favor of like smacking off all that cement stuff and deriving a pole to stick it on in there.
I believe it's on one already.
They must have picked the pole location to put it in.
Well, it was just, it was
just when... You hit a boulder, you know.
Bob Rice set that when the moving wall was up to Stop and Shop.
Okay.
And it was, and the water was just about...
Right.
Even with everything, so I can't mention there's much stability.
I don't know the area, but maybe we should pound a rod in around that area and just do an exploratory and see what's down there first. You know, you get a gutter, put a big bar in and be done.
But that was a donation when the moving Vietnam wall was in.
I hate to have to lift it up and set it on a new bar with the concrete base.
I don't think the concrete's holding much there.
No,
right
it
now.
Isn't. It's rotten. It's still pretty heavy, though.
I'd make a motion to allow the Pack 105 to use the Herring Run on the 23rd from 2 to 4 for their outdoor pack meeting.
I second that.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. It's unanimous.
Carl, go off.
Yep.
Maintenance of Herring Run Park. We need to vote to have, or do we just need to build?
Well, yeah. In other words, as long as we know...
Do we have a list? That I can get a copy of the list of what you're looking to do.
Yep, I have it right.
So how does that work? The conservation pays the DPW to?
I have screen scotch
to work there?
For the window?
No, actually, we just...
Okay.
But we're not going to, the DPW is not going to have time to get involved with these repairs. We'll find somebody.
Yeah, but we're going to have to find somebody.
Yeah. But I have screen.
I want to say we utilize the DPW a lot and really... They are not responsible for doing our work. They've always been very good at doing it. And I just sometimes fear we ask more than what we should of them.
No problem subbing stuff out either, but also general help. Somebody wants to do materials, that's a good thing. I have a big roll of screen for the windows if we need it, instead of buying a whole roll. I have a nice roll of that stuff.
I think it's a glass.
Glass. Yeah,
I don't know glass. Whether it's broken or it just fell down.
It's actually clean. It's like somebody took it out.
Yeah, it almost looks like I haven't been inside. I didn't
maybe
have
it's pushed in and on the ground inside, too. I don't know.
Who's got the key?
I'd like to clean that place up. I have a fitting that goes through the wall with a double line stainless steel fitting. I wouldn't light a fire in the stove there with a tin plate over the wood where the double wall gas heater pipe goes out. But it would be nice to put it to a position where it could be used and safely, but also clean the building up.
Do we know if we have jurisdiction over the building?
We have.
Oh, we do, okay.
Yes, that's what I'm bringing up.
That was in question.
I'll bring it up here. I would like to clean the building up. I think there are some political signs stored in there and stuff, and a few things in the tow here or there, just.
Haven't been in there in a long time.
The old bats and the nice stuff are just gone, you know, that's the biggest problem.
The chair's still there, that's the most important thing.
That chair's gotta stay. Sat in that chair and swiveled like, I was a little kid, I sat in that chair, thought it was gonna fall over backwards, I was.
No, that's just true.
I'd like to clean up, you know, is that acceptable to clean that up?
Yeah.
Not dispose of anything, but do anything valuable.
Will you be able to check the window and?
Yes, I'll go down there.
And the pipe, that's on the list, was the pipe.
Yeah.
We have a couple of other things that, like, we wanna spray the roof, or clean the roof.
Yes.
Pressure the roof and then oil it, because it's a wood shingle roof.
We used to oil roofs all the time.
Yeah.
All the time.
And paint the building and, you know.
Nice.
Probably have paint probably stored somewhere that you probably don't even have to go out and buy it.
I think we can find paint around, yeah.
Some of these I have, I'm not gonna actually make my dinner meeting tomorrow night because of town meeting, but some of these, maybe I can run by PAC 43.
Yeah.
And maybe, I know that most of the kids got community service hours they need to do.
Yes.
So maybe myself and the scout master can get together.
Absolutely.
And see what we can do to help you guys out.
Yeah, no, that's working, helping everybody out. Including kids, because they get ownership of by work, and that's.
You think they could, or you could fix the bridge there?
Well, I'm gonna go look at it and see what, because the scout master also works with us, so see if I can grab him for a few minutes when we get down and take a look and see what we can do.
Materials, like I said, sometimes you can get stuff donated, it's nice.
Yeah, sure.
I always think it's good to give an opportunity, like to Central Lumber or something, if it's a small project, to donate, and let them participate.
Even a big project.
Let them participate.
You got 801.
Okay, so 8:00 hearing for RDA 15 Blackbird Ave. Anyone here for that? That's what I thought. How are you doing tonight?
Good, how are you? I'm John Erder from Coastal Pools, and I've been hired by the Bradleys to install an in-ground pool in 15 Blackbird Drive.
What's all this? John, what's all this?
He's getting ready for winter.
I wasn't sure that was you.
I wanted to be ready.
You're a snowflake, if I grow a beard.
You made me nervous when you said Thanksgiving. That made me nervous.
Did you get your paperwork in, John?
Yeah, I have that in my truck.
Good.
I will get it in tomorrow.
Good.
But I'll be there, that's for sure. Okay, so you have plans? Does anybody need one?
Should be cold over there, yeah.
Anybody else?
Sure.
The wetlands are here over here. 29 feet from the wetlands.
That's certainly.
Okay.
The wetland here. What's the elevation like? Is this up on a hill or anything?
Actually, the back part of this house is like a knee wall, so it's half walkout, so it's very, very flat all the way back. It's actually, the level of the pool, probably almost to the erosion control, is the same level. The only place that it actually changes, if you're looking, standing with your back to the house out, over on the right side, if you follow some of the topos, this right corner over here by this drain system they have for the basement, that drops off 2 to 3 feet in that corner. But other than that, it actually goes up and then down, and then it's level. It's like a little hump.
Is that a French drain? Nice French gravity grid?
Yeah.
Oh, beautiful.
Yeah.
We'll see them often.
I know, it works perfectly, sure.
It does.
So elevation-wise, I don't think there's any issue right where the pool is and straight back. Just this one corner here does get a little bit low.
Trees and stuff? Are they...
Most of the trees, if any, that are on the... Actually, the pool, if you look at the farther side of the pool,
yep,
that is all lawn. So the pool would be sitting right in the lawn, existing lawn area.
Nice.
So we're only going to be going back roughly, say, 10 feet to the fence line. I put the erosion control back a little bit because there's some smaller trees, 4-inch, 6-inch. In this corner over here, where the proposed shed is, there's three pines. They're inside of the erosion control. All of these trees, any of the trees that have to be taken are for sun. They're not anything to do with, the sun does set right behind them. And this,
yeah, you have a pool, you want sun?
Well, there's a small row of them, and to be honest with you, once those, if you would let them come down, there's a giant space, so they'll have plenty of sun.
What's the size of those trees roughly?
Well, the three pines are big. Everything else is 6-8 inch and down. 30 feet tall.
They're not
giant. Yeah, but
they're big. I've been down there with them. The three pines that he's talking about are such that if we don't take them down now, then as soon as the pool's in, they're dangerous for the pool.
Right, that's what I'm saying.
They're going to be by themselves.
So, I mean, it's better to have them down now than it is after the pool when you got to bring in a crane to take them down.
It's just more sensible to do that. And again, it's within their landscaping areas and stuff. It's not out in the wetlands.
Nope.
So it's
like I said, the elevation part of it, I think, is key.
Yeah.
Plus the pool starting out right in the grass area.
Well, the fact that they have a French drain that works by itself, it says everything's engineered really well.
Yes.
This is volumes in my book.
What kind of filter, John?
We always use cartridge filters. Okay. So you can take them out and bring them to the car wash or out the front lawn or whatever, just hose them down. There's nothing that has to be transported into the wetland areas.
They don't have to be etched or anything, you just hose them down. They don't
take them
out,
hose them down, that's it.
Wow.
And use them until they wear out. Yeah. We usually recommend everybody gets an extra set. Yeah. They can soak them and clean them. And just keep switching them around like that. Yeah, works out good.
You should soak them behind the boric acid years ago.
Yeah, I don't know.
Years ago, I'm saying.
Yeah.
Things have changed.
These ones here, they didn't get my head, that might burn them.
You know.
And so the reason you're bringing it to us is because the wetlands are so close?
Conservation
yes.
Land,
right.
Looking
yes.
at the wetlands and making us pretty, so alarms not go blind. And, again, it's very responsible.
Yeah, the fence line's drawn, so
this will be all I want to be done. This looks like a piece of cake.
I move we close.
Second.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Will we issue a -3 with the following conditions: erosion control consisting of double stake hay bales or a silt sock having a diameter of 12 inches must be installed, the installation approved by the conservation prior to commencement of the work, no silt fence, termination does not allow any discharge of water into the wetland.
And then he can take the trees down that he feels appropriately to take out.
All right, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Have a good night.
Hold on. Hey, don't go late, John. We haven't voted on what I just said.
What's that?
Wait till they vote on what I just said.
Oh, I thought you just
second.
Second. Okay.
Okay, we have a second. All in favor?
All right.
Now you're done, John.
Thank you very much.
Have a good night, John.
Have a good night.
We have a couple minutes until the next hearing. What's our commission's holiday meeting schedule?
Okay. We have...
See you in 2017.
On Halloween. At work? Monday night. Tonight was a filing deadline. We haven't received any applications that want to come in on the 31st. Would you like to cancel?
Yeah, Halloween has not always been the night we wanted to have a meeting around. I don't know why, but we've always kind of canceled that Halloween on a Monday night.
Yeah, just sensible to keep traffic off the roads, stay in, it's a family type of thing.
And keep the kids away from our cars.
Well, yeah. Exactly, and mailboxes.
Yeah. And being as the only two pieces of business we had have asked not to be...
I'm already dressed.
Yeah, so...
Okay, so can we have a motion to cancel? cancel the meeting for October 31st?
Move that we cancel, we not meet on October 31st.
One second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed?
All right, but we have some more.
We also are scheduled to meet on December 26th.
Yeah.
I have a motion to cancel the December 26th meeting.
Motion. Again, normally we don't meet Christmas week.
Right.
It's a very tough week to get everybody, people are doing things.
Motion to cancel the December 26th meeting.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Bobby, do you have anything about the Nikes of Ball Fields tonight? It says Martin Nikes of Ball Fields. Is there anything? We still haven't gotten those trees for the conservation.
We have to put a plan together. All of us, you get together on that, put a plan together.
Yes.
And work with Boy Scouts, everybody, do a really good production. X amount, like, per
I
year.
I think we have to file for something to put them at Bog, right? We
yes.
have to do the paperwork, so we should start that now.
Do you want to do that? Do you know what to do?
Rick, I'll work with Rick.
Yeah, we'll okay. work together. Cool.
Right, you're talking about the Bog one.
The ball fields, talking about the trees, where to plant them. I think we have to come up with a strategy, like you said, a real plan, where we're going to, and get permission to do so, and then an amount we can handle and do a process where you do X amount every year. And I also like the idea of the larger trees that you had brought up. I brought, you know, elm trees. The
yep.
first one I ever saw in my life was in Pembroke. Then they died. I'm all for working within all the restraints.
So when do you plant those in the spring?
Springtime is the best, and don't hang around and wait for some holiday. When you get the trees, when they mail them to you, put them in the ground. Right. Don't wait for some pre-scheduled event. Just get them in the ground. Save a few ceremonial trees.
You were talking about some bog.
Yes. We talked before, you would always say put some in Tubbs Meadow. We should walk that around
yep.
and figure
okay.
out where they are.
Because I know one time you were talking about
12.
Up the drive from Bog 1, and we run into
a
secondary problem there because that's under federal control.
What, Bog 12? Or
All of, well.
Behind the one where we planted before?
No.
Oh, okay, so like to
that's
plant.
That's DPW's.
I'd like to plant yep. X amount there because that's a good spot. We found out we don't get too many predation there.
At the DPW?
Yeah, at the walking dogs. And those black racers, man, they keep the bulls down.
Yeah. That part would have to be approved by the DPW commissioners.
Right.
Tubbs Meadow
may be coming to change.
Is basically
right.
ours to,
exactly.
to do a seat
yep.
pit.
So we need to walk around there and figure out.
You want to do that on Sunday?
Yeah, I'll do that.
Okay.
Absolutely.
While we're talking about Tubbs Meadow, we had a volunteer call me here a few weeks back saying that the planks in the main reservoir at Tubbs Meadow were in pretty rough shape and the water was down. And could he go in and put in new planks and fix it all up while the water was down? And of course, I said,
go for it.
Yeah, go for it.
Absolutely.
Go for it. And he did. I went in, took them all out, cleaned it up, put in some nice planks.
Nice.
And then, on top of that, lined the front of it with a nice piece of some sort of plastic material. And it's all in. My only concern is, it may be a little high, but until we get some water,
you'll
we can always take out or
yes.
cut down
yeah.
a little bit more. But it was a volunteer, and I've asked Mary to send a letter. Next time we'll have a letter that needs to be signed. It's a local dog walker in Pembroke that saw our need and took over.
Yeah, I think that should be a good news clip, and it's good news. That's a really good thing because you don't get the opportunities every year
right.
to do that type of restoration. And he was on the site and did it. That's a good old-fashioned way to do it.
I need to do RE10.
And as he said, he says the boards will be there long after the rest of the steel is gone.
Well, that's always the way something goes.
Okay, it's 8:10, so we have a notice of intent for 28 Highland Drive. Mr. Salas.
Thank you, Rick Grady, from Grady Consulting. The applicant, Steve Salas, here. Uh, existing home, number 28 Highland Drive. What they're proposing to do is they do have a wetland area to the rear of the property. We had it delineated by John Zimmer. It consists of bordering vegetated wetland primarily, and there was an inland bank and a discharge of a drainage pipe in this area here. That drainage pipe starts out in the street, picks up the catch basin on the street, and runs down the side lot line to a head wall, and then discharges to the wetland. The 100-foot buffer zone to that wetland falls roughly through that area there and across the yard in this area here. There is an existing chain-link fence already in the backyard, depicted in this area here. It coincides with where we're proposing erosion control, which we have shown around the full perimeter of the fence. What they'd like to do is they'd like to upgrade their septic system to a new septic system. We did a perk test in this area here. We had a perk rate of 11 minutes per inch, and we had groundwater at the elevation 81.5, 48 inches below the surface. So we've designed a new 1,500-gallon septic tank. We're able to get by gravity to the distribution box in a series of ARC 36 chambers. We also want to install a pool in the backyard in this area here. The distances that we're looking at from the wetlands are 76.7 feet between the wetland and the leaching or the soil absorption system. We're a little bit over 50 feet to the proposed corner of the pool. We are proposing to step the grade down with the use of some bin block retaining wall in these areas here to minimize the grading. Dad, if you'd like to answer any questions.
Where's the water flow going to go off between the buildings, and what's the hydraulics when it rains on this property?
Sure. Today, we've graded the back of the house there's at approximately elevation 86.
Yeah.
We're proposing to bring that up to 89. They do have a lot of foundation exposed on the back of that house. There's about 5 feet of foundation exposed.
So what's the route of the water going to come around?
The water, it's going to continue in the same direction it's going
that
today.
It's going in today?
In this direction here, yes.
Nice.
So our contours are all in this direction here. Our proposed contours are paralleling the existing, so everything will continue in this direction.
Now, tree removal?
Tree removal, we located some stumps of some trees that were cut that we observed while we were out doing our surveys. We've got those stumps located.
No tree stump?
There were some trees, no additional trees to be removed other than the ones where the stumps were depicted.
Yep.
Right.
Those aren't trees, those are stumps.
Correct.
Storage of materials. It looks like a tight lot.
There really shouldn't be a whole lot of storage of materials. The sequencing that they're proposing is to install a 1,500-gallon septic tank,
right. Yep.
And then pump that as needed while they construct the pool, and then basically work their way out. There is a little bit of remove and replace on the septic system, down to a depth of...
This is on top of an existing system, right?
Yes, yeah. So we've got to pull out about 4 feet of material in this area here, which they're proposing to use as fill around the septic tank in house and on the uphill side of that retaining wall.
What are they going to do with the bottom when they get a leach pit? And that, I assume it's a stone pit?
On the existing system?
Yeah.
It's a leaching field, actually, yeah.
So 1,100 square feet leaching on stone?
Correct.
What are you going to do with the stone? Try to go on top of it with a space in between?
From the existing system?
Yeah.
It's actually the pool that's going to be in the area of the existing system. It's an existing leaching field in this area here.
Okay.
Yeah, so they'll dig out parts of that and use that as fill on the lot. There's no need to remove
just
that.
Be careful when you start digging into that black tar and stone. It gets appropriately dealt with. You don't want that laying around.
Yep, and that's one of the reasons, too, that they want to get the septic tank in there first so they can route all the flow to that. And
I'm talking about the residual that's left in the field in the ground.
Yep.
And you start to break into it. What are you doing that one, Bob? You break into an old field in the corner of a pool. How far in ground pool is that?
Was it 7 feet or so, Steve, the depth of the pool?
It's going to be 8.5.
8.5. Okay. Just want to have them run across. What are you doing?
Typically, what we see the guys do is dewater it first of all, whether it means leave it sit for a few days till it dewaters itself, or take a pump truck in to actually dewater it.
Sometimes it's that's what I'm saying. Sometimes you're getting sludge, not dewatering. Yeah. It's sludge out of those things.
Yeah,
I'm just curious.
A lot of times they have to bring in the pump truck, just like they get the septic tank pumped and actually pump
make
the
a little
sump
and suck it out of there.
Yeah.
So how would we watch over that process? What would we be doing? This is my only question.
You're talking about, you've got a cesspool, is that what we're working on? Working a leaching field, what are we working on?
We've got an existing 1,000-gallon tank in leaching field. The leaching field will be in the same locate, or is in the same location as the proposed pool.
They'll overlap. A corner of the pool will go in. Old field.
Old field, so you're digging out the old, part of the old field. What does the Board of Health say about the old field to the pool?
They're the same concerns that you raised as far as what happens to the effluent. Do you want the effluent to be just run off to the side, or in your case, run down to the wetland?
Or anywhere where it shouldn't be.
Yeah, so I think a condition that no septic effluent be discharged above ground, which is Board of Health.
I'm talking about the materials like the bed under the leaching field. I've seen them completely flooded and black with tar. So you start oozing into your 8-foot-deep hole. What are we doing?
Right, they're going to have to de-water that most likely with a pump, sewage pump truck to remove the liquid from it, and then blend the stone and the biomat in with the surrounding soil.
Cover it.
Is that, in some cases, it's removed off the...
That's what I'm wondering.
The property, I mean...
The septic stuff's kind of funny. If it remains on the property, then it's not considered a hazardous waste. If you put it in a truck and try to bring it somewhere else, then it becomes a hazardous waste.
Yeah, that's what I'm asking.
Yeah, so the septic, I suggest we remove the septic effluent with a pump truck, which is, has proper permitting to do that.
Yeah, not just in the tank. I'm talking about the stuff that's going to leach out, and especially start vibrating, digging, and moving.
In the existing leaching fields, right?
So if we're digging an 8-foot hole beside it, it's probably 5 feet or 4 feet. What water wants to do in sludge, it wants to seek its own level. So
yes, we'll need to remove the liquid from that and then blend that stone.
I would have to leave that up to the Board of Health, I would think. I don't know about the effluent removal stuff and blending it.
Yeah, I think that's a Board of Health issue.
We don't want to cross this off, so if you care.
Have you had a discussion with the Board of Health already about this?
Yes, we have submitted to the Board of Health. The review engineer had a few minor comments which he responded to. Actually, left a message for Lisa the other day, but I haven't heard back from her yet.
A lot of times, once you start to move something like that, it wants to keep moving.
We were around a question for us quite frequently. I'm not really worried about it.
It's one of these
things. Yeah.
It's like tar, it's tar, you remove it, it has its place. Put your cell back here, it's ground up, has its place to start. I do understand the process you're looking at. You only get double dip.
I think we're going to send, I want to send a note to Lisa to make sure when she approves it that she has something that says the existing leaching field effluent must be stabilized. And do it under her area,
And his condition referring to that is fine too.
Overdig it. Overdig it, throw in some hay bales, back them up, pull them out when you leave. I don't know, whatever you do.
That's kind of up to the contractor. As long as we say it has to be stabilized, it's up to the contractor and the...
Gotcha. Not trying to be a thorn in your side, just didn't run across that one yet.
Yeah, once you have money.
So that's a notice of intent. Do we have to vote on that, or is it?
Yeah. Okay. So notice of intent. We got a number.
DEP file number SE56-974.
Okay. And will we close?
Second.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, the hearing's closed.
We build according to plan with the conditions that Board of Health approval. For it all, backwash from the pool, cartridge or whatever, not into the wetland. Draw down of water from the pool can't be released directly into the wetland. Any fill on the site should either be stored more than 100 feet away or have a second set of, stabilized, so we aren't going to have a problem if it rains. The fertilizer, we have the regular fertilizers that you low nitrogen, it's a normal...
Slow release.
Normal thing. Erosion control is either silt sock of a 12-inch diameter or a hay bale is double staked with whatever, and that they need to be inspected by the agent before work is to be done.
Wood chips.
Yeah. And then there's all of our other boilerplate issues, and I'm going to put one in about the effluent.
Okay. So now we need a vote to approve the
OCC.
OCC for 28 Highland Ave.
A motion that we approve that OCC for this project.
Yeah, build according to plan with conditions.
With conditions. OCC.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
It's unanimous.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Happy morning. Hey, guys, I'm on a salt water field.
Oh, okay.
Cool.
Is it gonna be? It's not gonna be salt water. They're pretty cool.
All right.
Less chemicals, I guess.
Yeah, probably.
That's gonna toss up, I think. I don't know. We consider, you know, we were told that it is more corrosive than like. Electrolysis, oh, yeah, more electrolysis. Whole lot more electrolysis with the salt. You're right. You're absolutely right.
Don't forget to add dinner to that. It's late. Nope.
Okay, let's read these tomorrow. That's the end of our scheduled items. Does anyone have anything else to add tonight?
I do.
Right.
As usual. I walked the site down at the Bridges development on the 139 in Pembroke. And I don't know what part of the site's going to have buildings, but everything looked great until I got down to the back corner, past where they put in the hay bales and did a good job and all that. But the tractor pulled in, and they had already staked some of the subfill. And when he pulled in without a load in his bucket, he went down 2 feet. When he backed up, it came up 2¾ feet in that back corner, about 150 feet out to like 200 feet down the corner line, was soft as could be underneath. They were filling on top of it. I don't care if, as long as the building isn't on it. I'm not a professional, but it came back up. Boom, just so you know. You might want to just... I don't know if there's a building on it, it's not good.
have to see it there. I believe that if there's a problem there, they're going to correct it. Right? The people that I've dealt with down there are very professional at what they're doing and all. And so if they've got something in the ground and they start digging, I don't believe they're going to just... say, oh, I didn't see that,
right,
because they're going to have to stand behind whatever they're putting in down there.
It might be under a siltation pond. I don't know. I have no idea what's in that back corner. I didn't really look, but I went around, and it definitely was a big, it was 2 feet right to the hub.
Yeah.
Came right back up.
That whole area,
you know,
Rick, to me, was always questionable. It was questionable when the houses were put in.
Yeah.
Up there, Father, everything in there was always questionable. But
wet and questionable.
One of the things that I have learned through the years here is sometimes you can't question the engineers because you don't stand a chance.
Right.
I mean, the courts told me that very plainly one day. That, if you didn't have a degree and a bunch of letters after your name, you didn't know anything about what you were talking
especially
about.
Especially growing cranberries.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, and it was in the cranberry part of it.
Yeah. But a piece of rebar rod will tell you volumes about defects.
Yeah, so a lot of these things I look at and I have to kind of judge what these men that I dealt with down there so far have been,
decent people.
Look like they should be building, you know, the big towers in the city. They didn't look like they were strange to the business.
Yeah, but they are under a real-time restraint, and that's where you can have problems.
Is that something the truck driver would tell the engineers?
There was a soil guy there, and when he saw it, looked at me, he walked over and picked up a bunch of soil and started running through his hands. I didn't say anything. I'm just doing what I'm supposed to do.
Yeah.
I have to be in the wrong place at the right time all the time. It's terrible. Another one, real quick.
We have a monitor on that job. No, there is a monitor on that job for all of that work.
They just staked in a bunch of hay bales down in the back truck in case they're going to have a big rain.
Yeah.
And it was, if that's at your back, it was straight ahead 20 feet and over 5 feet right there, that spot. So I acted as another thing, not to be a, since they put the rotary in, which I love watching people, so far I'm the only one to drive around it with a piece of paper looking to see where I am, so.
Oh, you mean down
here? Did that as a joke. Had to be the first one. But at the garage on the corner, in that little brook that goes under the road there, there is a horrendous amount of stuff due, I think, to those recycling containers. People stop there, they throw out like tires and junk. And
well, this big pile of tires that looked like it was retrieved
out of when
Landis was...
Oh, okay, out of the water. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, they're going to get, they're responsible to get rid of that stuff.
Okay, I didn't know that. I was just saying.
Those boxes are actually...
donation boxes, ain't it?
But the guy who owns the garage is paid.
Yeah, $500 a year, and the new guy who may be coming in there doesn't want them there. He wants to clean up. He's going to work with them. But I just want to make sure that he gets addressed. There's a whole bunch of stuff there that, you know, would be good for it to be gone.
Well, I would think he's got to work that out with the owner that has it right now.
Yeah, I just wanted
to have those removed, right?
Right. I would suggest that, but also I just wanted to put in the record there's a whole pile of stuff there that...
Yeah, it looks like when they did some work there, they might have cleaned it out. I know we've been in there twice, taking TVs out of there.
Maybe we should think about some chain link fences in certain places where this keeps occurring in life.
Toughest thing, it's out of the scope of work, so it falls on the town.
That's what I'm saying, though, is sometimes you get extra, you know, fences get thrown away or it's hard to recycle. If you don't want it, a second-hand fence is better than none. Work with an owner or a renter or something and try to work with them. Get something done. Because otherwise you're going to keep cars, televisions out of there, and it's going to get better and tires.
I don't think we can actually do anything until they've completed their piece.
Yeah, I just wanted to put it up on the table and kick it around because it's definitely...
it looks like they might
have pulled it over the excavator. That's one place I wouldn't go in with just my wetsuit on. I mean, my booties on. I wouldn't go in that hole if you paid me. That place is... What's in there? You know, a couple of safes.
A lot of years.
Yeah, a lot of years.
Yeah, there's a lot of stuff going in through that
one. But that one, and again, I looked at the film just recently of the back of No Bottom, and had the canoe recently stolen that we use in the fisheries, and we've had some people offer up some replacements, which is nice. There is a reward of $100 out for it, and like to work those things together. Like, we get stuff out of the environment, where do we put this stuff?
I would imagine the recycling center will take the tires.
Okay.
They have a demolition dumpster up there, so I would imagine we could just work it out. I think Ed and Sabrina are in charge of trash now. I don't think the Board of Health is.
Yeah.
So I would imagine we just have to work it out to be able to take it to the recycling center.
But since we're trying to work out with the school now doing a junior herring fisheries commission where they do their public service and all. Gun-ho to get some stuff done. And we could use it.
Yeah.
Get it done. But yeah, it's always been the way. When I get a truck load of small stuff, like a couple of bags of stuff and bottles and trash, I just put it in the dumpster at Herringbrook. Because it's from Herringbrook, further upstream or downstream, but that's where it goes. And only stuff out of the brook and around it for put in there.
Don't worry about what's
always
in there,
open.
People out of town stop by and use that
I've
dumpster.
Seen some horror shows there. Horror shows.
We've locked it. They popped the locks off. So.
There's a number of things on the administrative business. Let's go through those. There's one thing that we have open meeting law training next Wednesday night at 6 p.m. It's here at the town hall, I believe. They want as many people to attend as possible, so please attend. It's mandatory. Okay, it's mandatory that you attend. So I just read something that didn't say
that, right? The 25th?
Yeah.
No, but I'm saying that the one that makes the 25th
at 6 p.m.
Right? Yeah.
We're in it.
They just opened all the doors up.
They're doing it during the meeting while basically.
Yeah. Because so many people have been having difficulties.
3 o'clock, they couldn't schedule it during the day.
Right. Okay, so that goes with the whole book like that.
Okay, I think that's it. Can I have a motion to close the meeting?
Any newer other business to talk about? Anybody? Newer other business? They could be to close the meeting?
Second.
Town meeting tomorrow night?
Yes.
Which, at the high school?
Yeah. 7 o'clock this year. It used to start at 7:30, but for some reason they went to 7 o'clock.
All right. We have a motion to close. Do we have a second?
Second.
On favor?
Aye.
No, please.